We're a heartbeat away from the next episode of How Do I Know You? I can't believe that I said a heartbeat away. I'm just so corny.
I think you guys have what it takes to go all the way to the top.
Got to have love.
A new film by Robert Townsend.
In your heart.
With a lot of music.
Some people run at the first sight of song.
And a big heart. The Five Heartbeats.
I want you on my label. Let's make a deal right now.
We're going to go and record our first single.
And I want a gold record.
A new house.
Oh, I got nothing but love for you guys.
They were just five guys from the neighborhood who created a sound that rocked America. The Five Heartbeats.
Wow. Just watching that trailer evokes so much emotion for me. You know, as an actor, there's not many times that we get the chance to work in a film that lives literally forever. Now, they all live forever on some level. Some of them we wish would die. But in this case, this is truly a legendary film that I have seen easily 15 or 20 times in my life. And I just happen to have one of the Five Heartbeats, who happens to be my dear friend. He's really a friend off the stage of the Five Heartbeats. He's a good brother. Love this man. And so without further ado, let me introduce to you my friend, my brother. He's in LA. He's smiling. I see him. TICO WELLS. My brother, what's going on? What's happening?
Man, you know, we entertainers, man. We're really our own kind of gang, aren't we?
Yes, we are. Yes,
we're
we
our
are.
Our own kind of fraternity. And it's beautiful, man. What is up? How do I know you?
How do I know you? We're going to get to that right away, man. But it's really good to see you. You know, I'm here in the Southeast missing my L.A. people. And so you doing good?
Man, I got my cousin here, man. He's like a son to me. I always tell him that. And I'm so excited, man. He's visiting me for a few days. And it's just, I got him, man. I got him on a program, man. We've been hiking. I had him at the beach drumming. I had him, you know, he came to my acting class yesterday.
Whoa, acting class? You teach? Teach acting?
Yeah, of course.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, I've been teaching since the 80s. When I got out of New York University, I started teaching with kids in Queens. Ving Rhames and Eric LaSalle and Lisa Gay Hamilton and myself, we used to teach at this, it was called like a vacation Bible school in the Bronx. First, I think Ving had it or Eric had it. Then they passed it on. Then Lisa had it. Then she passed it on to me. And it was like a summer school thing that we did at Grace Church in the Bronx on Grace Avenue. And I took kids down. This is when the Empire, the World Trade Towers were alive.
Yeah.
And I had about 40 or 50 kids, man, that I had to take on the subway to the World Trade Towers. And I remember every inch of the way, I would count off and say, all right, count off, because I was not going to lose anybody's child, man. So there, one, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, six, seven.
Got them all. So you're teaching kids now, or are they adults?
No. I'm working with adults. I coach privately.
Okay.
I coach in small groups right now. Yeah.
I didn't know that I was following your footsteps. I have an acting class now too. That I actually love it. My wife,
I love teaching.
Me too, man. I love it too. So it's
especially
really cool, and I'm glad
you're
doing it.
At this point in my life, man, I just signed up for Social Security, man. Can you believe it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you dig it?
So are you telling your age? Are you older than me?
I'm 62, yeah.
Oh, I'm older than you.
Yeah. You're my elder.
Yeah. Yeah, and probably a lot more than it appears. Speaking of hiking, and yes. I know how you roll, because I see you through terrorist posts. Remember this?
Yes. Yes, I took you on a mini course.
Oh my God. What was wild about it, Tico, was it was, man, first of all, I thought that I was in somewhat of good shape. We're walking around this trail in this park. It's hot out there, and you're stopping at each station doing like 40 or 50 push-ups or pull-ups at every. I'm like, and then you're trying to get me involved. I tried, but I couldn't keep up with you, brother. I could not keep up with you. That's a big part of your life, huh?
My cousin is 37, so, you know, I had to show out a little bit for him today. So me and Tara, we were running, man, on this course in the Gurun Hills. We were running like intervals, like run up this hill, then walk, run up this hill, walk. And she doesn't run. Tara is my dear friend who doesn't like to run. She was running. She was showing off for my cousin. You know, he's young.
Right.
You know, big young cat.
She's trying to impress your cousin, huh? She'll run for you, but she'll run for him.
She ran for him. She ran for him. It was impressive. It was impressive, man. But no, I mean, the next zero I see is going to have a 7 in front of it, man.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know? And as I, you know, we got some awards last year for the 5 Heartbeats. Like, it's starting to be like Lifetime Achievement Awards and Outstanding, Outstanding Achievement and stuff like that. That's stuff they give to older folks, you know?
Right.
But it was beautiful. We got an Adelco Award last Thanksgiving in New York City. Which is a theater award that they give to Black theater. And, you know, we're getting older. And, you know, a lot of the kids haven't seen the 5 Heartbeats, but then a lot of them have. The parents are exposing them to it, and it's like 33 years have gone by. And I'm like, hey, y'all, but I've done other stuff. I've done other stuff, man.
It's not the only thing
I've done. But it's a blessing, man, that people keep coming back to that movie. And Robert always said, I wanted to make a classic movie. And I guess this is a definition of a classic movie. It's still rolling 33 years after we made it.
It's rolling hard. I don't know why I have two Blu-ray discs. I have two Blu-ray discs of the 5 Heartbeats. I don't know why, but I got two of them. And I watch it, and I've shown it to my younger kids as well. We make them watch these classic Black films. And, you know, I was having a talk with, and I'll get to this lady a little later, with a mutual
Diane
friend of ours.
Carol. You just showed a clip of Diane Carroll, man. Bless her, man.
Mm-hmm. And we were talking about the fact, and then Robert's very open about discussing how the film didn't do the business that they hoped it would. And I said to this person, as I was discussing this with her, I said, well, yeah, you know, there are films that did do really big business that we've forgotten about. The 5 Heartbeats, on the other hand, though it didn't do the business they thought because the studio screwed it up, Fox really messed it up, and you know that. Even though they messed it up, man, that film is living forever. That film, as I mentioned in my intro, will last forever. And you were a part of that. I got to ask you that this first. I'm going to go back to my next question. Living in this five heartbeats world, what does that feel like to you as an actor?
It gives me something that I can always be thankful for. Mm-hmm. Even though, you know, it's work I did 30 years ago, every year, every day, it's a part of my life. And Robert told me that when we were filming. He said, you're always going to be choir boy. You know, and he was right to a certain extent. You know, I think what people want in this business is to be recognized for their talent and also a level of fame kind of validates that for a lot of people. The older I get, though, I realize that it's not who I am, but I'm extremely grateful. I've done a lot of different things in my life. This being the most widely known thing that I've done or that I've sort of acknowledged for. But thank God life has taught me that it's not who I am, man, because, you know, people, if I tried to live off of Hollywood, it's really can be shallow.
Right.
Fame.
Right.
For just, it's an ego trip sometimes, you know? I don't know what I'm saying. It's a beautiful thing. I always wanted to be rich and famous and successful and an actor, a star. But now I'm a star within, you know, spiritually speaking. I've had a chance to grow, and I think in a lot of ways that I'm not more famous has helped me to do more spiritual work for myself and to recognize that I'm a child of the universe. And this creative acting thing is just a part of it that I can use as a tool to develop myself, you know, through discipline, through repetition, through growth and learning and creativity. So I love my life, man. I love my life. I love my life.
And that is the key. And what you just laid out there is, to me, a description of maturity and depth of a depth of person, you know, because I had one of these with two of my friends a couple of weeks back, Richard Whiten and Tony Winters. I don't know if you know those guys. And we were talking about the fact that in this business, you know, 20 years is what an overnight sensation is for many of us. And I know that I can vouch for at least Richard, who said this, that had I made it when I would have thought that I would have made it, I don't know if I would have handled it right. You know,
it for you when you say made? What does that look like for you?
Well, let me just go back. Well, it means something different now than it did then. So when I was starting out, it was, you know, I get on a TV series and make a few movies and people recognize me. I get paid a lot of money. That's no longer true. The way that you described is what it is for me now, because I'm very happy right now. Out of the things I have left to do, certainly, but the journey is what's making that happen for me. It's just enjoying every day and getting up and having these conversations like I'm having with you right now. That is really the truth. And when you say what you just said right there, that's exactly how I feel. You know, that's exactly how I feel. And then God is so good, because God always provides what you need, the food to eat, the crib, you know, my YouTube TV that I can turn on and watch whatever I want to watch, you know, that whatever I want to do, you know, go in and hug my wife and have her slap me around a little bit. I mean, my life is great, right? It's great.
And it's, you know, funny for me. Tell me if this happens to you, like, family and friends, you know, they really want you to be a star because they get a little juice off of it, you know? Your friends get a little juice off of it.
Right.
Right. right?
It's all good, man. It's all good.
They want you to win, you know, because when you win, it feels good for them too. And I feel like that about my family and friends too. But if they, you know, everything is kind of compared to, you know, the big stars, you know, the Denzels and Will Smiths and Chris Rock.
Or whoever.
Whoever.
But,
what they perceive as stardom.
Right.
The Kardashians. Okay, they're stars, you know.
Right.
And they don't know that we're all people. We're just people, like the Wizard of Oz. He's just a dude. The Wizard of Oz is just a dude, man, you know? Mm-hmm. And there's nothing more important for me than to be at peace and to be happy and have loved ones around and to make a difference in the world in some way. You know, I've got two movies out right now that are, one has just been released on Amazon Prime and Tubi. It's called Sasha Lanes. And it's a story of a young girl escaping a dysfunctional family. And she's running from Detroit to California to reconnect with some family out in California. And I'm her estranged father that she gets to meet.
Is that Mark Casey?
Yeah.
I know Mark. I remember that you shot a film with him. So I have to go and check that out, man.
It's called Sasha Lanes. There's an actress named Sasha Lane too. Sasha Lane. But the movie is called Sasha Lanes with an S. And then I did another a faith-based movie. I guess anything dealing with the Christian church or God, so to speak, is called a faith-based movie.
Yes.
I guess that's the marketing term. But one of my good friends, Shedrack Anderson, stars in this movie called Jacob Broken by God. And I think they're still finalizing some distribution stuff right now. But I had a great time filming that in Houston. And so those are two films that are, you know, the most current. And of course, working with you.
Yes.
A couple summers ago was fun, you know.
I was going to actually get into that later on, but the whole experience was great, but you know, you guys really, really changed the tenor of the show in terms of the amount of fun they were all having on this thing and the subtlety that you brought. A couple of your moments, man, are classic.
Look at that beard, man. Look at that beard. Yeah.
Yeah, man. Yeah. So that was a good time. That was a good time. So listen, that's a good segue to the theme of the show, which is how do I know you? Now, I don't know that I brought this up. I know exactly how we met. So I want to see if you know. I'm not going to tell you what it is. I'll give you a hint.
I just know we would see each other at events, and you were always the gentleman, the kind person, the complimentary person, and you had the reputation, which you still have, of when people say Carl Gilliard, in parentheses, or, you know, colon, a good dude.
Oh man, God bless you, brother man. The same could be said
everybody, anybody who knows you, if they have a problem with you, it's their problem.
Well, I thought that I was the one who said that. I'm kidding. Sort of. Kidding, not kidding. So I'm gonna tell you how I met you. I'm gonna put something up on the screen and it's gonna be a strong hint. Let's see if you get it. Here it goes. You see it? See who that person is right there?
Oh, did we meet through her?
You did. We met through Monique Manning. That's how we met. You know how, I'll tell you what it was. So
when she was moving or something, she was moving into that new place.
That's right.
We helped her move.
And that's how I met you. And I was looking around for the clip and yesterday, and I pulled it off of her audition reel. I said, oh my God, there goes the clip, there goes the clip. So I can use it when I do the show.
And I think you told me that recently, and I still forgot.
That's how we met, brother.
In that scene, man. We were so young, innocent. She was gorgeous, man. She's still gorgeous, man. I saw her recently.
She and I used to do theater together back at the Inglewood Playhouse back in the 90s. We're talking, you know, around the time Heartbeats came out.
Yeah.
And we used to work together. And then from that play we did, we just became friends. And we used to hang out all the time. We were very, very close. And I think
she's
that
Dutch.
When we helped her...
She's Dutch.
Yeah, I know. And we helped her movie. It was you. I want to say it was Courtney B. Vance might have been there too. You, me, and a whole bunch of dudes were there helping her move. That's the kind of pool she had because she needed help. And we all showed up to help her move.
You know, it's something to be said about fine. Fine is a currency.
It sure is.
It's really a currency. I mean, let's face it.
It sure is.
But, hey, my YouTube channel, I've been having so much fun with.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you for doing one of the clips.
My pleasure. Let's talk about that for a second. Let's talk about
Make
that.
Make Peace You. The letter
yes.
U.
Mm-hmm.
Make Peace You. That's my channel.
And,
that's my
and what
channel.
Is, what is, that's your channel, but
that's
so what is
channel.
It? That's your channel.
That's channel.
But what is the what is the per what is you, how do you
own
see
the platform? I don't own the YouTube. I do not own YouTube. They can actually take me off anytime. I'm giving them free content. Isn't that crazy? Think about
I almost
that.
Said that. I almost said that a bit.
Think about
I did
that.
Just say it.
Would anybody in the old days have given CBS free content? That was a brilliant idea for them to come up with. And then they dangle, you know, if you get to so many subscribers, we'll give you pennies and we'll start paying you pennies. But anyway, I love it that you don't have to ask permission.
Mm-hmm.
And it's up to you to monetize it, however. But I do it as a contribution. And if I start making some money off of it, cool, that's cool too. But it came off of a project I was doing at a workshop, a self-improvement workshop called Self-Expression and Leadership Program.
Right,
Landmark. You ever heard of Landmark? The forum, Landmark Education. You know anybody did the
yes,
forum?
Yes, I have.
Used to be EST training. Mm-hmm. But anyway, we had to do a community project, and this was part of my community project in 2011. And I started doing it, started getting monetized and everything. And then I got busy and just dropped it. And then a couple of years ago, I was like, wait a minute, I got like 100 videos up. I got Herbie Hancock and Bruno Mars and all these great people. And now I got Chaka Khan and Carl Gilliard and all these people. And I said, I just asked a simple question. How do we create peace? How do we create peace? That's the only question I ask.
I love it.
And I ran into Nicole Murphy Wednesday, and she did one. So
did
check
she?
Her out. She's still looking fine.
And
it was great because I don't know if people always give her the opportunity to express who she is outside of the physical, you know, and I give people that opportunity to just speak something that's not related to keeping up with the Kardashians or what car they drive or how much money they got or how many chains they have. You know, how do we create peace?
How?
You know.
How? So let me shift a bit here. Mr. TICO WELLS, my brother.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
I don't know this part of you as well. So you're from New York, right?
No.
See, I thought you were from New York. Where are you from?
I was born in Columbia Hospital in Washington, D.C.
Okay.
I'm from Southeast.
Okay.
Southeast Washington. Mm-hmm. Not Southeast. Southeast.
I want to get that right. Southeast.
Yeah, Southeast.
Southeast. Southeast.
Which grew into the hood.
Right.
The hood. But, and I grew up right outside of D.C. in an area we call PG County, Prince George's County, Maryland.
Okay, right, right.
Maryland. Or Maryland.
Maryland.
I'm from Maryland.
Maryland.
I'm from D.C. and Maryland. But my dad moved to New York.
Okay.
And I followed him as soon as I could. And I went to college in New York at New York University. It. And
undergrad.
Undergrad.
Did you major in theater, dramatic arts there? Okay.
I started in a school in Maryland called Bowie State College. Mm-hmm. It's now Bowie State University. And then I transferred to New York University because I met an actor when I was about 15 who told me, if you want to go to college and you want to study acting, you should go to New York University.
Mm-hmm.
And being a young brother from D.C., Maryland, or the DMV as we call it now, my family's from Virginia. So D, District of D.C., D.C., M, Maryland, V, Virginia. So I'm from the DMV. So being a young man from the DMV, I didn't know nothing about no New York University. It sounded good.
So someone led you there then?
He just put the seed in my head. Mm-hmm. And so through high school and everything, I kept thinking about Gilliard, you know, American Academy of Dramatic Arts, and NYU. But when I got out of high school, I didn't really have high SATs and all that stuff. So
I didn't have all that, man.
It was like, they were like, dude, you ain't got the credentials to be coming up in hell. So we ain't gonna let you in. But my little HBCU was like, come on, Tico. We know you. You was at one of our summer programs when you was in high school. Come on through. You ain't gotta worry about nothing. Don't worry about no SATs. Come on.
So you're at NYU, you graduate, right? Okay, and so when do you get to L.A.? What makes you come to L.A.? Is it you just want to be a famous actor?
First time I came to L.A., I graduated in 84.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I finished in December of 83, but I walked in 84 with my class. And as soon as I got out of school, I got this pilot called Summer, which was like Beverly Hills 90210. Before Beverly Hills 90210. It was high school. We shot it at Van Nuys High School. It was me and a white kid who were the leads, and they flew me out here. And I was just fresh out of college, man. I thought I was on my way. I got me a pilot, going to get a TV series, man. We're going to do this thing. And they aired the show, but it never got picked up. So that was my first Hollywood disappointment and success.
Right.
And I said, I'm coming back. But I went back to New York, did a lot of theater, did movies, worked with Al Pacino and something called Sea of Love. And
I remember that movie, Ellen Barkin.
All the black people except Samuel Jackson got cut out.
Sam was in that too?
Sam had a part in that, yep.
Wow.
Sam used to get all these little parts, man. I first saw Samuel Jackson in a play called Colored People's Time. And I remember looking at him saying, that dude's got something, man. And matter of fact, Angela Bassett was a friend of mine, Kim Staunton's understudy.
I know Kim too.
New York.
Yeah, I haven't seen Kim in a long time. Is she still in L.A.? Have you seen her lately?
I saw Kim Staunton? A few years ago. I texted her.
Okay.
Yeah. But... and Courtney was on Broadway with Fences.
Fences, right.
He played the son. I eventually got to play Corey in Atlanta. So before I was doing the Five Heartbeats, I was in Atlanta at the Alliance Theater under Kenny Leon, who's blown up and done so many things now, directing-wise. But Kenny was the artistic director of the Alliance. And... I kept hearing on the grapevine that, you know, I had gotten this movie that I'd auditioned for couple of months earlier, Five Heartbeats. He said, I heard you got the role. I'm like, nobody told me. What? I mean, it was like this underground rumor going around that I was cast, but nobody told me, you know, officially. So I'm like, how did they know? Why are they saying this?
Who are the theys?
Just random actors would come up to me and say, hey, man, congratulations. I heard you got that movie. I'm like.
That's crazy. That's crazy. So it sounded like Robert leaked it or something, or told the studio but didn't call you? What?
Yeah, and Robert didn't even have a script or sides or nothing. I was doing a play in New Jersey at the time called, what was that play? Not the Colored Museum, but Zora Neale Hurston's Spunk. It's called Spunk by George. Damn, man. You know, when you get older, man, you do start forgetting stuff. George Wolfe.
Yeah.
George C. Wolfe. Yes.
Right.
Was the writer director of a Zora Neale play. And I remember my agent got me through this long line that Robert Townsend had. I mean, it was at this theater and it was a cattle call. But I had an appointment time. And I remember it was raining that day. I came in, had a suit on, and I had to get back out to Jersey. To New Brunswick, New Jersey, to do my show that night.
Right, so,
I came in there, and you know, I had met Robert before when he directed Raw. Remember that, Eddie Murphy?
Yeah, I do the Eddie Murphy. Yes, I do.
Yeah, and he didn't remember me from that because you know I was a little peon. And so anyway, I come in there. He goes, hey, man, how you doing? I'm Robert Townsend, man. Robert Townsend. Hey, look, so listen, we're gonna do some improv. Okay, look, We're a singing group, man. Okay. You're on drugs, man. And he had me doing Eddie's part. He had me doing Dressler's part. He had me doing everything but Duck. And then he said, okay, you're from the church, man. You're from the church, blah, blah, blah. And we were just improvising and, you know, just having a good time. And then at the end, he turns to the casting director, Jackie Brown, and said, hey, put him down for choir boy. He'd be good for choir boy.
You know what's great about that? What's great about that story is, and see, I don't know Robert as well as you, but I do know Robert. I've been around him a few times, and we know each other. He has great instincts, and he has a great memory and a great sense of people.
Yeah,
that's my take. Would you agree
Robert
with that? Is that your experience?
Raised well.
Yes.
His mama raised him well. Nice. He's a good person.
He is.
And he's been a mentor and a friend and just a, you know, a role model, man, for me. He was, you know, when I went to American Film Institute to study directing, he was right in my corner, you know.
Nice. This is after Five Heartbeats, I'm assuming, right?
This was after Five Heartbeats. I went in 93, 94, went to AFI. And I started playing around with directing and I saw him do it. I saw him act and direct at the same time. And I'd heard of people doing it before, so I knew it was possible. I haven't done a feature yet. I want to do a feature one day when I find a script that really slaps me around and says, you got to do me.
Right. That's what it takes for me. I mean, I've directed theater primarily. And that's how I feel about even theater that I direct. And I think that I'm a really good theater director, speaking humbly. Because all the plays I do that I direct, they always come out extraordinarily well. And they're audience favorites. People love the plays that I work on because I have a certain thing that I do that I think works. In terms of the energy around the pieces. But Robert Townsend, I got to tell you this Robert Townsend story that always stuck with me. Because before Five Heartbeats, I actually auditioned. That's the only cattle call I've ever done was the Five Heartbeats, and which was a whole nother story. When he did the documentary, Robert hit me up on Instagram. He said, hey man, look out for the documentary. You're gonna assist up. He actually hit me up and told me that. But before that, around 2000, it's a true story. I was at the American Black Film Festival, which was then the Acapulco Black Film Festival. I'm telling you, I did not know Robert Townsend. So I'm walking to a screening, me and some friends, and Robert's coming towards us. He looks at me and he says, "Hey, Carl." I'm like, "How does that dude know my name?"
Was that in Miami? Was that the one in Miami?
No, it was that same festival, but this one was in Acapulco.
Okay, I was in Acapulco too. That was a ball, man.
Oh, I loved that festival. That was a ball. I try to get there whenever I can. But he was so nice to me. I had no name tag on or nothing. He called my name. He says, "Hey," and that totally made my day. I'm like, Robert Townsend knows who I am? And at that time, I hadn't done anything much, I guess.
Carl, famous, man. You're really famous in L.A., man.
Famous?
For a long time.
Wow. That was something that really, you know, from the perspective of just how kind he was to me. To your point
Let me blow it up. You, for me, have always inspired just kindness, man. And you know, you one of those guys that I can say, man, your mama raised you right. Somebody raised you right or raised you well.
Yeah. And my mother threatened me well, yes.
She threatened you well. But no.
Yeah.
It reeks out of you that you want goodness. That's how I perceive you.
Yeah.
It's not
Thank
the
you,
truth.
Brother, man.
It's not the truth. I'm sure there's someone out there that goes, "I can't stand that."
Oh, man. Yeah, there's a couple.
But.
But it's all good.
But. Hey, you know, we've been around a lot of people, man. To continue year after year after year liking certain people, man, that's a feat. That's a feat.
Well, I have to tell you, I just appreciate your friendship, Tico. And, you know, and even in recent times after we shot 2 Degrees, you know, we've hung out at the health food joints and you got me trying to eat vegan and I'm not feeling it, but I'm trying harder, you know, and I appreciate all of the input. You sent me those herbs, which I have to tell you didn't help me much. We had to get off of this and talk about that because I'm going through some things that are quite surprising at my age. I'm 65. Well, and in the last year, I'd say more succinctly the last 9 months, I'm going through a change, Tico Wells. So I'm trying some different dietary changes. Like right now I'm doing something and taking different nutrients. But, you know, you might better help me with that because I know how you
roll. Well, let me just say this. First of all, it's good that you're open, that you realize that there may be something other than what you might have thought. I'm trying not to put down the traditional American Medical Association. I'm trying not to kill that, but at the same time, I'm trying to let people know that that is just one path. That is not the truth. That is not the only answer. People lived thousands of years on this planet without no American Medical Association and did just fine.
That's right.
The thing is that we live 40, 50, 30, you know, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years doing, you know, building up certain habits that don't serve us. And then we want to turn it around overnight. Because I guarantee that when you met me, it's not the first time you heard about health. It was always something that it was somewhere in your world. You may not have pressed that button in terms of certain things that you're learning now. You didn't have the wife that you have now.
Yeah, see the big difference.
Okay. So we want to reverse all of these things after growing up. Listen, I grew up with Captain Crunch and Cheerios and Fruit Loops and Twinkies. Right. Do you remember Twinkies?
Hey, man, I was worse than that. You remember those orange cupcakes that Hostess makes? Those orange cupcakes and Susie Q's?
Man. Susie Q. Hey, look.
Man, I loved all that shit.
You lick all that white out.
Oh, man. Yes, yes.
Chocolatey cake, man. Hey, fruit punch sodas.
Yep.
What the heck was that?
Poison.
What was Tang?
Ooh, you hear that thunder? No. Double Tang.
No.
That's a big thunder outside that just happened, man. I was like, what?
No, that's because I mentioned the product.
No, but all those things we grew up on.
What was you know, Tang?
It was powder. It must be toxic, probably pretty toxic stuff.
Orange.
Yeah.
With sugar in. What was straws, man? You remember straws or pixie sticks they called them?
Yeah, pixie sticks. I still love that.
What the hell was that?
Sugar?
And then when things just go haywire, we act like, oh, I got a problem. Give me something quick. I need something quick. I've been doing what I want to do for a long time.
Long time. And me, I am the...
something quick. And I don't mean Nestle quick.
You know, I'm a sugaraholic, Tico. And my wife would tell you, you know, even...
You got white sugar in the house? You got white sugar in the house?
Not anymore. I mean, okay. But
what are you
but
sweetening when, stuff with now? What are you sweetening with?
Monk fruit. She got it. I don't know. My wife brings stuff home.
Okay, you got to... Okay. This is your opportunity now to stop blaming it on her.
No, I'm saying I don't know what it is. I'm saying it's not...
Give me credit. Hold on.
Yeah.
This is your opportunity now to mm-hmm. take full responsibility for the artist known as Carl Gilliard.
Yes.
And not anymore saying, well, my wife handles that.
No, what I'm saying is you asked me, you know, what did I have in the house? You, brother, and I'm just telling you that it's not white sugar. It's something else. It's too, and, you know, maybe I'll ask her and text you later. But it's not white sugar. So we don't have
you
any white
need,
sugar.
You have an opportunity to learn these things for yourself.
Yes, yeah, I do. Yeah.
And now, for me, it's no longer an excuse for me not to know what the hell is going on out here. Mm. And I'm inviting you, not telling you what you should do. I'm saying, Mr. Gilliard, it's time.
Yes, indeed it is.
And you it also got to be patient with yourself. Whatever ailments that we come across, it's in God's time. Mm-hmm. The healing is in God's time. But the medical profession has taught us that if we take this pill or we take this drug or this vaccine mm-hmm. or whatever manner of poisons they want to give us, that it's instant. Mm-hmm.
And that's be crap. That's not true.
And what the health consciousness, from my perspective, is transforming the cells all the way down to the cellular structures in our body, giving them food, real food, giving them real sunlight, mm-hmm. giving them real water. Not the stuff that Bill Gates is trying to come up with. The fake burgers that he's got going, the impossible something and the beyond something. I'm not talking about that fake stuff. I'm talking about a real strawberry grown in the ground, a real cucumber grown in the ground, a real mango, papaya, these things. We could live off this stuff.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But it is a journey. It is a journey of transformation to reverse the programming, because this programming, we're addicted. We don't really need that much food.
Right.
It's just that the commercial industry has, and we've all participated in, because we wanted them checks. Buy this, buy that, drink this. We just wanted them checks, and we wanted to be out there. Oh, so-and-so's got a commercial out selling God knows what to people. And particularly the kids, we sell all kinds of foolishness to kids through the commercial market. And I'm thankful that I had brothers and sisters pull me out of it, pull me by the coat and say, listen, man, eat coconut for 40 days, clean your body out. That's how I got started. I went on a coconut diet for 40 days, man. And it was some of the most superhuman days I ever had. Some days I was drained as my body was trying to get rid of all the junk from childhood. You know, some of the things that came out of me was incredible. Matter of fact, I could use one of those kind of fast right now, but we have to be patient and we have to see it as a responsibility to ourselves and to the next generation to protect the planet, protect ourselves, protect our families with real food. And I know some people out there are very Bible associated people. It talks about it in the Bible all over the place. Let the herbs of the field be man's medicine. You know, talks about hyssop and a whole, mentions a whole bunch of herbs in the Bible. We need to.
No, you definitely preaching right now, Tico.
I'm preaching.
And you're preaching, and believe me, you know, I'm on a journey now. On my own journey, and I'm reversing some things that I have done to myself, even as I enjoyed all of it. But I'm definitely going through a change in the journey right now, helped by my wife, who is, as you know, very, very conscious of these things, man.
So shout out to her.
Yes. I married well, and God knew what I needed. So I'm very happy about that, bro. So listen,
you don't know when the healing is going to come.
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed.
You have to program yourself that it is coming. Project that thought and know that it's in divine time that the reverse is going to happen. We got to clean out the old cells, let those old cells die out. Stop trying to vaccinate ourselves and burn ourselves up and radiate ourselves and all of this foolishness.
Right. All right, bro, I'm going to jump off right now, man. You know, we're out of time. Man, I have enjoyed talking to you, but don't go away because once I enter recording, I'm going to pull you back up. We can talk a little bit more about this, my brother. So thank you for being here. Tico Wells, how do I know you? Now you know how we know each other. And this great man, I'm thankful for you being here, man. Man, now you got me all sober. I'm like, okay, you know what I can, what I know, else can I go I cut? Know, what can I go out and cut out right now? But it's all good. It's all good though, man.
The other side is so beautiful. You can have all the money in the world, but without your health and your mind, it ain't nothing. Got nothing but love for you, baby.
All right, my brother. Hold on. Don't leave. All right, now. Take care. Thank you for tuning in. How do I know you?